Hey guys, so if you remember back in my September 2012 Birchbox video, I kind of went on a little tangent talking about authenticity in the YouTube beauty community, and I just wanted to do the actual vlog that I sort of promised that I would do about that topic. And I actually had taken notes and like formulated all my thoughts, but then I left them all in California. So I'm just gonna go off the tippy top of my head. So I'm split 50-50 on the issue. Part of me absolutely loves YouTube for the glimpse into people's lives, and it's authentic, and it's what they're using, it's what they're buying, it's what they're willing to spend their money on, it's what they really think about a product, and it's nothing that's related to any PR companies, marketing campaigns, nothing. It's not something, you know, a magazine is telling me to buy because they have this partnership that I don't know about with whatever brand. Because when I was younger, I really used to listen to magazines, and when they would say, oh, this is the new must-have like lipstick item, and I'd be like, oh, that must mean that it's amazing. Like, I had no idea that like all this marketing went on behind the scenes when I was like 10 years old, because how are you supposed to know? So that is kind of where I am half the time, and then half the time I'm like, well, blogging is a way that people can make money. I mean, I make money off AdSense, off my videos, because ads play in them, and that stuff helps me out, and I buy clothes with it, essentially. Like, a lot of, sometimes my haul videos are just all funded by the ad money that I've made on YouTube. I don't really make that much, like $200 a month. But, I mean, it's still something that it's like, I'm putting a lot of work into it, so it's nice to be able to get that. And so if there's somebody who is wanting to start up kind of like a blog or a website, and they want it to be like, I want to be a beauty review site, then they should be able to get PR samples, because why should they have to buy things just to do reviews? So I guess the problem that I see with it is when a personal blog gets blended in with like a review blog, because it's like Temptalia I have no problem with, because it's like, that is your like beauty resource. You go there for information. But I think the problem with YouTube is that a lot of people are kind of like in love with a person, and they see this person, they think, oh, I think this person is very, very cool. I want to be just like this person. I want to wear what she wears. I want to do that. And so it's kind of hard to separate out the person from this kind of review thing, because I find myself, like, when I'm watching YouTube videos, it's like, I really, like, see this person, I relate to them, and I want to be their friend, like, in a weird way, and it's just like, oh my god, like, I love this. So I don't know, I feel like I don't like it when it comes off like it is, like, a business pretending to be just, like, a person. It's hard. That's the thing. It's like, it's hard to even say that. Like, part of me thinks that like that shouldn't even be a problem either. I think what happens is that like a lot of like really popular bloggers and YouTubers and whatever, they've grown out of something that was just like their own little baby and this own little personal blog, and like, this is what I like and I just like talking about it and blah blah blah. And then they've become popular and they've connected up with companies, and so the people that watch them are people that may have been watching from the beginning and really love them for this, you know, authentic aspect of their life, and they're not able to kind of like adjust with the fact that it's like, okay, now this is changing. Like, this isn't just a glimpse into Susie's life. I'm not putting quotations, I don't know anyone named Susie. This isn't just a glimpse into her life. This is now, companies are using her as a way to peddle their products because she is an influencer. And part of me is like a little weary of that. But then at the same time, it's like, if you are an influencer, shouldn't you be able to use your status to your advantage and actually benefit from it and make money from it, just in the same way that anyone else would from any other skills that they have? And so it's like, it's really, really hard to describe, because part of me doesn't give a shit, because it's like, it's my responsibility to see something and decide. No one makes me buy anything. No one makes me think anything. It's my responsibility to see something, hear something, and process it for myself and come out with the conclusions, and not just to go, she says I should buy it, so I should buy it. But it's hard to, I don't know, there's like just this weird thing with YouTube where it's like, you see this person, you're like, oh my god, I want what she has, ah, blah, blah, blah. Like, I can't even tell you how many times I've watched a video just like lying in bed, and all of a sudden someone starts talking about something, and then I have my computer in front of me, my credit card's out, and I'm just like, ah, I must get it. Like, it's very strange, but it's this fucking materialism shit that just overcomes you. And then part of me is like, maybe these people have a responsibility to not just throw out anything, like a celebrity. Like, a celebrity shouldn't just endorse every product that gets thrown at them. Not saying any of these people are, but just, like, you kind of have to look at your audience and think, like, do I have a responsibility here to, like, be more authentic and be more upfront and be more realistic and not just be like, oh, these people are willing to give me free makeup, I like makeup, okay, then I'll pretend like this makeup's the best makeup. Because it's very strange, like I said, how just because someone talks about something, how it's like all of a sudden it's like, oh, I want this, and you see it, and they say that it's good, but they might not be willing to have spent their own money on this item, and maybe if they had spent their money on it, it would change how they felt about it. That's another thing. It's like, you can get a PR sample and you could say, oh, I'm going to be 100% honest, but do you not want to keep your positive relationship going with a PR marketing company? And you, like, if you trash their products, like, maybe the next time they're not going to be as willing to work with you. There's only so many PR samples that can go out there. They go on to another person who'd be more willing to kind of provide a better review for the product. Just because, even though, like, I mean, but negative press sometimes is good press. It's hard to say. I'm just kind of all over here with it. So I've gone through and made a pros and cons list on just accepting products for review. And I thought about it, and I'm still 50-50 split. So, for instance, pros. It saves the person reviewing them money. Like, if you were gonna buy this Bobbi Brown lipstick in the first place, and somebody wants to offer you the Bobbi Brown lipstick to talk about, why wouldn't you accept that? Because now you don't have to spend your own money on it. You can just get it from them. It shows us stuff that we might not have seen otherwise. It might not be something that we would have known about. It might not have been something that we would have been able to swatch or see physically wherever we were living, or the swatches online are poor or something. Like, there are benefits to it for us as viewers if this person has access to a product that, you know, completely was not on our radar, and now it is because this person is talking about it. It also gives the person content. If you love somebody's personality and you love a person and you want to watch them having more items to talk about is more content for them to be able to make videos so that you can enjoy them. And how is it any different than, like, Temptalia? As I was saying, some people build their blogs as sort of like a review blog. We trust Temptalia to the nth degree, and yet we kind of get mad and don't believe some other people when that's kind of the same scenario. And why should they have to pour all this money into getting samples of items just to swatch it when it might not be something that they totally love and want to use all the time? So, as I said, like, but then when you kind of interact that with the fact that, like, YouTube kind of has this weird voyeuristic, like, real life glimpse into people's lives type thing, that's when you kind of get on the con side, and it's like, well, you started out as this person who I thought was my friend, and now I feel like you've manipulated me and you're using me, because maybe the review isn't 100% authentic because it's been influenced by the fact that you did not pay for this item. Because I might say, oh, this worked great, when it's like I didn't pay for it, but if I put $50 into it, it better fucking work amazing because that's my $50. And so there's that little thing where you don't have your bank account tied to it, where it doesn't exactly matter what happens, because it's not your money. And they show you things sometimes that you can't afford, and then you might get something stuck into your head, like, oh my god, I want that, but I can't afford it, or it's just totally out of your price range and you just don't care. But then at the same time, it's like, that's your own deal. Everyone in the world has different economic situations. It shouldn't be somebody's responsibility to cater to your exact personal thing. And also, it's like, if it's something that you don't even, like, this person doesn't seem like they're even interested, like the fucking PMD. How many people have reviewed the goddamn personal microdermabrasion surface, I don't even know, personal microderm system? They tried to get me to review, it was like, no, I don't want this thing. And for someone to receive the item, it's like, most of the time they put the stipulations on that it's like, you have to make a video about it, you have to, like, you know, say these talking points or whatever. And so then you feel used as somebody who has subscribed to this person, and you feel like you have this sort of weird relationship with this person, even though you don't, because, you know, hello, there's a camera here, like, I'm not in the room with you, we are not best friends, but, like, you know, there is a bond there. And so you feel used and just like, really, you're gonna fucking throw this in my subscription box? You would have nothing if it wasn't for the viewers, because the reason you're getting offered these things is because you have that many subscribers up in the top right hand corner on your channel page, and if every single one of them was gone, you'd have nothing. So I get into this weird conversation in my head of, like, at what point does a channel owe something to the people who watch it? And is that never, or is there a tipping point where this channel would have not been, like, a channel is nothing in terms of like PR samples and all that stuff, if there's no following, if there's nobody to sell to, if there's nobody to influence. And so if you have these people, then you have something. But if you don't have them, you have nothing. But at the same time, your viewers love to watch you. So who can complain here? Who can say, oh, my viewers are being so annoying in the comments? Or who can sit there and say, oh, this person's being so annoying on the video because either don't subscribe or, you know, don't bank on your viewers for being able to receive items. It's this weird thing, and I'm still completely torn 50-50 because part of me sees as somebody who makes videos how it's like, yeah, it would be really amazing if fucking Zara, never gonna happen, but if they were like, hey, we wanna offer you a $100 gift card every single month because people like your Zara hauls, and I would be like, thank you, that's gonna save me money. But at the same time, it's like, then it feels fake because here I am being like, woohoo, here's all the shit that I got when my life is already like that, because no one knows like anybody's economic situation. Like, I'm very like happy in life and I am very privileged and my mom is so fucking generous for me and I love to go shopping with her. But some people don't have it like that. So sometimes it's kind of this like whole, like, I don't know, in sociology, it was like relative poverty where it's like people have these, people are able to buy all these expensive things. You know, you see videos on YouTube of like opening my Hermes bag or whatever, and it just makes you kind of like bitter and angry, like you can't afford it and like blah, blah, blah. But it's just really, it's really hard to wrap your head around. And like, these are the sort of things I like to sit and talk about. And this is like why I miss school. So I'm just trying to find like some sort of like philosophical, analytical, critical thinking thing to like wrap my head around and really just like bite into, because I have, you know, no more school going on and it's kind of sad. But so another thing that I was also thinking in terms of like cons of PR products, but not really, was like at the same time, okay, let's say that my cousin gave me something and she gave me like a lipstick and she said it's her favorite lipstick and she, you know, was really excited for me to have it, and then I, you know, was gonna talk about it or review it or whatever, but she watches my videos and it would probably hurt her feelings if I said I didn't like it. Like, you guys don't know about all the stuff that can go on behind the scenes in a scenario where it's like, well, maybe I say, oh, this lipstick's really great because I don't want to offend my cousin. That's never happened. No one really gives me lipstick or anything. They just give me gift cards, so woohoo, gift cards. But yeah, so there's different things that could influence people's opinions that you don't know about just besides being a PR sample. It could be that they bought something on recommendation from Essie Button or something, you know. What's up, Estee? Love you. And then they didn't like it, but because they love her and they don't want to, like, I don't know, offend her. Not that I think she cares, Estee. You're, like, traveling India right now, so have a really good time. You're not watching this video. Is this weird to be talking to you in the middle of this video? I'm just going to stop it right here. But yeah, so it's like you might buy something that somebody recommends that you absolutely love, or like a friend, if you have like a YouTube friend or something, and then you don't want to do like a bad review because it's like kind of being negative about something your friend liked, and then that might like feel awkward. Like, I don't know how people are. People are strange. The base of it is that when it comes down to like, I feel like using PR samples, it matters people's intentions and their actions and how they do it and how they portray it. If I get this iPhone and it was because it was given to me and it's like, oh my god, this is the best phone ever, you guys should definitely get it, it makes your face look really nice and I really like how it looks and blah, like blah 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 blah, if I don't really feel those things, and if it's just like a total fucking sales pitch, like, why are you trying so hard to sell this item? And the same thing goes on with like affiliate links. Like, I put affiliate links for anything that I've purchased. If it has an affiliate link for it, like, I'll put that link for it because it doesn't change any difference. It doesn't, you know, make a difference to the people who actually buy the item. They're not paying any extra. It's just kind of like a commission. It's like cents. It's nothing. But it's just something where it's like, hey, I mean, maybe this person wouldn't have found this item if it wasn't for me. So just like a salesperson in a store, like getting commission in that sense. But I mean, seriously, guys, use your Ebates, you know, refer yourself. I'm trying to teach you about using the Ebates, but nevertheless, it's still one of those things where it's like, oh, well, I put a lot of like effort into it, so it'd be nice to see like little amounts of change roll in just to kind of like see something for my efforts, because like Ryan and I were talking about it, he's like, it's so cool that you're able even to get like a tiny bit amount of money from the stuff that you're doing, like with your blog and your YouTube, like even though you love it and it's a hobby, it's really fun to be able to like see something coming out of it, because he loves to write comedy and he's like been writing this book for forever and it's like tons of pages in Word and he tweets it a whole bunch and he wants to do all these different things, but it's like, you know, there's not a single penny he's ever been given for doing any of that. So he's just like, it's really cool that like on YouTube and with blogs and like with shopping and with beauty and everything, that there's a way to actually kind of monetize a little bit of what you're doing. But at the same time, it's like, that's not why I'm doing it. That's not why a lot of people do it. But I feel like at a certain point when like blogging becomes your job, that is what you're doing. Here are some questions that I have for you, and you can answer them in the comments, and I'd just be really interested to find out people's opinions. I'm missing these roundtable discussions from school. So, okay. Does it bother you that people make money from AdSense ads playing before videos? Does it bother you that people receive PR samples? When you know that something is a PR sample, does that change your opinion on it? And do you tend to stray away from blogs that and YouTube channels that are just mostly featuring items that they've received care of or PR samples? Or do you prefer someone who's, you know, sitting in their house like, hey, this is what I do, this is what I buy, this is what I wear, and nothing is, you know, thrown on them from the outside, marketing companies, PR companies, and the like? Do you guys feel any sort of hostility towards people that you see becoming more popular and receiving these things on YouTube? Like, do you feel betrayed? Have you ever felt used when you're watching a YouTube video and you know that it's a sponsored video? Do you feel that there's possibly like a tipping point where a channel exists as it does only because there are so many people watching it? And do you feel that even though all the content and everything would exist, and the person would exist, and the camera and everything that they're doing would still exist without the viewers, but because you guys are there, that do you feel some sort of like ownership? And do you feel that there is like a responsibility of this person, especially if they have like a younger, more easily influenced audience? I think it's really important to be very mindful of what you say and what you do. But at the same time, does the fact that you have a gigantic audience of say 100K subscribers, should that change anything you say? Or is it always the subscriber's responsibility to take what they see with a grain of salt and figure it out for themselves, process it for themselves, and come out with their own conclusions? Or, you know what I mean? Because it's like, okay, now that there's 11,000 people following me on YouTube, I don't want to say anything irresponsible, you know, make any sort of accusations, say anything before I know if that's true or not necessarily, because there are repercussions for that in terms, like, you know, you might just be actually saying a lie that you don't know is a lie, but it's like, you might just be like, oh, I hate this stuff before you've actually tried it out, and that could really influence people's opinions. So do you feel that because there's so many people watching, like a certain person, that there is some sort of responsibility they have to be 100% on the ball, saying everything right, not saying, you know, shit that's not true, making sure that everything is tried, tested, and true when they do a review? Or do you feel that the number of people subscribed to a channel doesn't matter? The person should be able to put out whatever the fuck they want to put out, and the number of people watching it shouldn't matter at all? I'm torn between those two, because part of me feels, my channel is my channel. I don't give a shit how many people, if zero people watched it or if 100 million people were watching it, I would want to say what I would want to say. And then part of me thinks, if there were 100 million people, I would need to watch what I say, and I can't just say things, and there's a responsibility that comes with that many people listening to you. Let that simmer. I'm not wafting a fart. Just let that simmer. So, I hope that this was interesting and that you have thought about these kind of things, or if this was like an issue that you were kind of feeling, that maybe now you have a place to voice your opinion. So in the comments, answer those questions that I posed and let me know what you guys are thinking, because I am really curious, because it's interesting, because I'm in YouTube as somebody who's totally obsessed with so many people on YouTube. I love watching YouTube channels. I have so many favorites. And I am somebody who will go out and buy something that somebody talks about. But at the same time, I'm also somebody who makes the YouTube videos. So I see it from two different ends. And I'm torn between the two different ends, because part of me would be like, no, I want no ads. I want it to be totally authentic. I want it to be this, 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 and this. But then the other part of me is like, no, if you have a capability to make money, you should be able to make money. Thank you guys for listening to my rambles and my tangents, and let me know what you guys are thinking down in the comments, answer the questions, and have a great day. Bye.